Welcome to the Cannabis Equipment News Podcast. Hi, I'm David Manti, and welcome to a new episode of the Cannabis Equipment News Podcast. With me today is Chris Mylan, VP of Sales with Cannabusiness ERP. How are you doing today, Chris?
Great, David. How are you?
I'm doing good. You know, we're in the middle of the week. I'm feeling all right about it.
Yeah, it's Tuesday.
Oh my goodness, it's only Tuesday. It feels like the heart of the week. I got a sick kid at home, so it's just, I'm living it all. Before we get started, please make sure to like, share, and subscribe to the podcast. You could also help us out a lot by leaving the podcast a positive review on whatever platform you use. If you want to email the podcast, you can reach me at david@cannabisequipmentnews.com with email the podcast in the subject line. Chris, jumping into it, I wanted to know a little bit about your role in the cannabis industry. Did you come to ERP from cannabis, or did you come to cannabis from ERP?
Yeah, so we came from outside of cannabis into the ERP world. So we were very much a food and beverage kind of specialist in that industry, which, you know, has to do very similar qualities and needs as a cannabis customer needs, right? It's about traceability, you know, FDA compliance reporting, recall management, you know, all those strong inventory and costing, all those things that you need to worry about supply chain are all the same, very similar things that you need to worry about when you're running a cannabis company. So for us, it was a very easy intro in. We had a handful of customers very early on that we really weren't doing a lot around the cultivation, more processing and distribution and financials. And then, once we found a consulting firm that came to us and said, hey, we really need some help. And what do you think? And we're like, I think we could probably help. So between that and a couple of customers, we started in 2015 writing the Cannabusiness ERP solution.
How many changes did you have to make to the ERP software system from the food and beverage world to suit cannabis?
It wasn't much change. It was add to. So we could leverage our recall that we already had. We could leverage our strong quality module and some enhancements that we've done around that, and some stuff around production sequencing. All of that's those kind of current products that we already had built were very applicable to this. So what we really need to spend time on is waste management, Health Canada reporting, state reporting and compliance and integration work, and then really writing the cultivation piece. So once you're in processing, the it's not any different than you would use inside of the platform. It's really around cultivation, gardening activities, fertigation, capturing all those costs along the way, giving you a grower's workbench so you know what needs to be done today in what room and which crop needs to be taken care of. So it's really more the handling of that, of the day-to-day operational side and capturing those costs. That was probably the big piece that we had to make sure that we got right.
So for the people out there in the industry that are unfamiliar with ERP software, what is the 10,000 foot view as to how it works?
Yeah, really, it's really meant to track your day-to-day lives and what needs to be done and capturing all of those direct costs and managing your inventory and then producing the financial statements in the way that you need to see them, but giving you, visibility with dashboards and KPIs, key performance indicators, so that you understand kind of what's important and what's not working right. It really helps you get operationally very strong because you start to look at different facilities and, why am I at a dollar per gram in New Mexico, but, I'm over here in Florida and I'm at $1.50. And why is my yield stronger in Florida with all the humidity and trying to deal with the environmental control system than it is out west if I've got so it really helps you kind of dial it in and understand what's going on, but it makes you run a better business so that you can reduce your cost and make sure that you get the most profitability you can out of what you're doing.
How many cannabis operators are using ERP software?
Oh boy, that's a great question. I would say if you're at the 50,000 square foot and above, most people are a semblance of an ERP. Some of it's might be commingled together with multiple solutions that are integrated together to call it an ERP solution. You know, most MSOs for sure, most of the large LPs in Canada are on an ERP solution. But there are some of the smaller ones. When you get down to 20,000 square foot and lower, you know, they might be piecemeal and still QuickBooks with maybe still using, you know, BioTrack, even though it might be the compliance, but they're still running it as their internal operation stuff. So it gets a little uglier, you know, in some of those, because it's just difficult to use and it's really meant for compliance and not really is meant for running your business every day. It's really just tracking the plants, right? So once you get past that evolution of, yep, I've cut my license, I can track my plants, but now I need to know more and I need to get better at what I'm doing, especially around pricing and costing, that's when ERP starts to make more sense for people.
Okay, so it doesn't necessarily make sense for the smaller players in the industry.
It may or may not, depending on how they're operating and what their end goal is.
Okay.
Right. There's in the early on in the industry, right, the goals were very different. You know, you had people that were like, hey, I just want to get something. I want to keep my plants, my licenses, and I want to sell. And there's, you know, and then other ones were like, yeah, I want to sell to one of the big boys. And if they're using your system, I want to run that system to make it easy transition for me to move into, you know, another MSO's, you know, solution that they're running for ERP. And then you have others that just aren't sure. So, and they don't have a lot of cash. So they're going to take a little less expensive route, which there's nothing wrong with, but eventually you're going to have to replace that. Right. So either do it now, right, and kind of bite down on the bullet of the dollars, right, because the investment's going to be a little bit bigger, or, and I'm going to kind of limp along for a while until I get to that inflection point where, wow, I really need an ERP. And then, you know, then you're going to spend the money then.
What is that inflection point or that threshold?
I mean, it's different for everybody. It just depends on where the pain points are for the business. Mm-hmm. You know, it's, you know, am I struggling on waste management and just making sure that, you know, my yields are good and, you know, what strain profiles are working the best for me? And, you know, what's my fast movers and my slow movers? Do I have too much inventory? Not enough? It all depends on the business and how it's run. Because what happens is, and we hear this all the time, I'm in spreadsheet hell. Like, you know, this is really like, you know, when they get so fed up of scheduling their crops in Excel and trying to track cost and trying to manage their teams and who's working on what in the cultivation facility and the processing side. Once that gets to become just, it's too much, because as you need to ebb and flow and change directions and move things around in rooms and, or if you're in greenhouses, you know, adjusting that, when all that gets too much in Excel, that's typical when they just get so frustrated. It's like, I got to get something better.
So after they make the leap, how long does the integration take? What does that process look like?
Yeah. And again, this will depend on the sophistication of the company and where they've been. If they've used a little bit smaller ERP before, they can move a little quicker. If it's their first time, you're 4 to 6 months, you know, before you're kind of up and getting comfortable. We did one company up in Canada that got spun out. They were on SAP. It wasn't working great for them. And we spun them out in less than 90 days. Like we spun them up quick. One, they had to, because they just got out and they had to get off the system. So they were super motivated, but we moved them very, very quickly and it went very smooth. So it just depends.
That's a transition that I've seen from other equipment manufacturers and companies that have worked in other industries, is they're used to a longer timeline where the pace of change in the cannabis industry is really fast moving. Has that impacted your company at all?
The fast moving has definitely impacted the company, right? You definitely have to shift. I mean, we continue to write enhancements to the product and we're listening to our customers when we do that. And we did a major release, 420, shocking 420 in 2020. And that was over 100 enhancements, right? Listening to what customers' needs were, tweaking some things the way that we were doing the processing, which was fine, but they just wanted it a little bit differently. And LPs in Canada are definitely wanted a little bit different than what we do in the States, right? There's some things that, you know, a 1 million square foot grow facility is doing that a 50,000 square foot, when you're tracking plant by plant, right? And they don't track plant to plant up in Canada. So it's just, you know, there's just little nuances that you have to make sure that you have, the system has enough flexibility to be able to handle the different scenarios that pop up.
What were some of the more major enhancements that you introduced as a result of customer feedback?
You know, I think the biggest one that we did is we were really hooked into the work order solution, you know, part of Sage X3 is because we're powered by Sage X3. Mm-hmm. And we thought that was super smart when we first wrote it, because, you know, why reinvent the wheel? Like, we've got a really strong ERP foundation layer, and it's, you know, SQL based. It works very well, very powerful, and the traceability is amazing. But what we found is when you need to make adjustments and changes, if you made a mistake, because we were so coupled in, that was less flexible. So we actually broke it apart. So our cultivation kind of stands on its own now. And it also enabled us to do separate waste management for process and also for cultivation. So by kind of breaking that off, that was a pretty major endeavor for us, but it really paid. I mean, it paid its dividends. People, when they see it, are like, this is, even some people that have been with us for a long time have looked at it recently. The new version was like, wow, this is what I always envisioned it to be. Like I feel like we hit the mark, right? It was a strong solution in the beginning, but we really took it to another level, and it's getting a lot of good feedback in the industry.
Does the cannabis operator need a designated employee specifically working on ERP software, or possibly several?
It depends on how they're structured, but typically, you know, that head of cultivation is spending a lot of time in there, or whoever they decide, you know, is that person. And then it comes into the point of grabbing the labor costs. And how do you want to do that? Do you want the laborers to enter their time, or do you want someone to kind of control that at the head of cultivation level, and they want to get that time in a little bit differently? So there's some decision points that you have to make during the implementation, and there's no wrong answer. It's basically how they're structured and the skill set of the team that you have in front of you.
After the integration, what can an operator expect once it's up and running?
You know what? What they can expect is starting to see some reporting that they probably have never seen before, or if they have, it was very hard to get accomplished. And you're seeing it real time. So when you're looking at your dashboard as head of cultivation, and you're seeing your cost per gram, and you're looking at, hey, here's what's going to go to harvest next week. Here's what's moving from room two to room three. And, you know, you can really actually see it's full exposure of your, you know, what your business is doing today. Right. So you exactly can see a little bit better in planning. So you can understand kind of what's going to finished goods. What can I get to the dispensaries? You know, what do I need to build, you know, make? So, you know, what's the next crops need to look like? What should I expect, you know, from a yield perspective and a costing perspective? So you really start to see kind of like how the pounds are coming and getting made, and how it's, and the grams are moving along. So that's the part that's really cool, is because the reporting is so strong, you really have much more exposure to everything that's happening, and you can make some better business decisions instead of kind of like walking the floor and trying to figure out what's going on. Like, you know, it'll kind of, you know, especially if you use some of the indicators and stoplights, right? It'll show you, if it's in yellow, I need to be looking at this and why this is going wrong. If everything's green, right? So it just depends on how you build those. But we've got standard dashboards built for all the kind of standard stuff that everyone needs to look at, whether you're in finance, if you're an inventory manager and you're dealing with that, or if you're in the cultivation processing side, you know, we've got dashboards for everybody, so they can really look at the information very quickly. And I think that's a big change for a lot of people. Is just the amount of reporting that you get and understanding the exposure, kind of what's happening in the business.
Can that type of reporting and all of a sudden like deluge of information be disruptive? And also, how can operators get ahead of that to sort of help with employee buy-in in the company?
You know what? The employee buy-in comes into is, I think, during the selection. I think when we do our first overview demo, there's a handful of people on there that are probably part of the committee, but we kind of like when, and most companies are starting to do this, is they'll bring in a lot more people into the big detail demo. Okay. So they can really understand and ask the questions like, oh, here's what's happening. I'm struggling in waste management. You know, we're trying to figure out, we're bagging it, but then, you know, how do I get that reported into metric? And, you know, is that the right way to do it? Or they're struggling around, you know, how their process is moving from veg to harvest and flowering, and they're not sure what's going on in there, and they're struggling capturing these costs or capturing the actual activities that need to be happening, and they're not getting done properly. Those, all that stuff just kind of flushes out during the presentation, because they're asking all those questions and they're asking all the what ifs. So you can watch them. You can just kind of see all the excitement happening and starting to see the possibilities of what a solution can do for you. Instead of them working so hard to get where they need to get to, you can take a lot of steps out.
What are some of the problems companies are having with waste management?
You know, it's just the tracking of it. You know, it's so important, and it's making sure that you get the compliance right for that, right? It's not like, you know, you drop, you know, you're in a bakery and you drop some flour on the floor. No one cares, right? Mm-hmm. But if there's a leaf on the ground, everyone cares, mm-hmm. right? I mean, I think we're probably over complicating the waste, mm-hmm. I think, to a certain extent in the industry. And, you know, which is just more compliance, which costs more money to handle the compliance, right? It kind of goes into the, you know, the taxation stuff too. I think we could do a little less regulatory if we had some better systems in place. But, you know, that part of it, though, just making sure you do it right, it gets bagged and captured properly and gets scanned. And then, you know, you make sure that it gets uploaded properly into the compliance part.
What kind of investment are operators looking at, and what kind of ROI can they expect?
So investment varies depending on the size of the are you an MSO or not, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, the dollars can change drastically from, you know, in the middle of six figures up into, you know, we've done deals that have been over $1 million, right? So, mm-hmm. but again, those are very large organizations that have lots of facilities, lots of cultivation, and they're north of, you know, 500,000 square feet. So it just depends. The ROI happens pretty quickly, especially from a reporting standpoint, and not having someone that's just worrying about metric reporting and that's all they do. Mm-hmm. You know, there's still some things you have to do in metric that we can't do in metric because metric doesn't allow it. And BioTrack's got a little bit stronger integration because BioTrack's a little more flexible. And I think BioTrack's working on, metric's working on that, because we had a good meeting with them in Vegas, and they were trying to roll out some stuff in this Q1 that's supposed to open up some more APIs for us. Mm-hmm. In the industry, because it's a limitation of that, not us. We're very open and we can kind of do whatever we need to do. But, you know, the ROI, I think it happens, you know, in that first 6 to 8 months. It's once you start really dialing it in and everyone's comfortable in the system, and we've done all of our testing before we went live. So we're making sure that we're ready for go live. But, you know, there's a little bit of pain. ERP is not fun. So, you know, getting it put in properly is, it's an effort on not just our part, but really the customer. They have to do a lot too. You know, we ask a lot of them because they own it when we're done. Like, you know, we'll help them and support them always, but we want them to turn the keys over so they can drive the car. You know, we shouldn't be driving the car every day.
It seems like Metric has had a cultural shift in terms of really working with integrators and offering those APIs and sort of being a little bit more accepting of who's trying to use the platform. Is that what you've experienced?
We have. So, you know, in the beginning it was super difficult, but yeah, the new regime seems to be different. Like, you know, we spent some quality time with them at the show, and I'm starting to feel better. I want to see it, right? But I mean, what they're saying and what they're trying to accomplish, if they get it done, it's going to be very helpful. For sure.
Is it a subscription-based purchase? I mean, or do you just sort of pay per seat? How does the cost structure work?
Yeah, it's subscription-based. So, and it's based on users, but it's concurrent. And there's different user types, right? So there's a full user, and then there's, you know, manufacturing and operational users, and then there's cultivation users. So all those user types have a different price, but it is a subscription-based that you pay every year.
Do you have a particular client or clients that you like to use as a case study as to how to do it right when bringing ERP in-house?
For sure. One that comes to mind is Pure Greens. They're, you know, up in Colorado. Been with us for a very long time. I think since 2013 or 14. Been there a long time. We've got a nice case study on them. You know, that's the old CEO was ex-Anderson Consulting. He had that pedigree, kind of understood kind of what he wanted to get done. He wrote a lot of his own dashboards to run the business on and KPIs, and just was structurally and foundationally strong. Like he was very strong in process, and he and his team bought in. And, you know, when we take customers up there to do on-sites, they're impressed. They're impressed at just how everything's very meticulous and it's very structured, and they know exactly what's going on and who's doing what. And it's pretty neat to go there and watch that. We've actually taken a team, and we hired some new consultants that we brought on out of college. They went there for a week and were cultivators and processors. Like, you know, Peregrine's got some free labor. I don't know how good the labor was, to be honest, but they literally were doing a day in the life at the end of their train or their 90-day training with us on the solution and understanding how we do it. They got to see it in action in a very efficient way, and it went great, and they enjoyed doing it, and our team loved it. Like to get that extra time and handholding and spend that kind of time in the facility and the greenhouses was really great.
No, I like the idea of the day in the life training, just because so many times people fit into that niche professionally and don't really know who they're serving.
Right. Right. And just, you know, hey, clipping mother plants and putting in the sponge and, you know, just all of the stuff that you do day to day. It's important to see in action and how the time is captured, the materials are captured, and, you know, they understand it from a systems, but actually doing it all day long, I think it's important.
A lot of operators pride themselves on being GMP ready and basically being ready to flip the switch in the event that regulation ever goes through on a federal level. Is ERP software something that you need in-house for when federal regulations kind of goes through?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So, you know, there's a lot of companies or people out there that think, oh, I have ERP, so I'm GMP. And that is not the case. You're only GMP because the companies with their processes, right, is certified because they're doing it the right way. The solutions, ERP solutions that are out there, they facilitate that and help you, but you have to have your business cases and you have to have all your SOPs documented. And if your SOPs aren't right, standard operating procedures, if those aren't in compliance with GMP, then you're not GMP, right? As you go through the certification. So everyone always thinks if you've got ERP, oh, I got GMP, because that's what, you know, we'll state in our, we support GMP because we do because of the SOPs, but you have to build out your SOPs, right? And then the system kind of follows the SOPs so that you get the reports out and stuff. So when they come in to make sure that you are certified and they do their mock recalls and all the things that you have to do from a compliance standpoint, that it follows along. It definitely helps facilitate that. But, you know, again, the company gets the certification, not the software.
Do companies in food and beverage and the pharmaceutical industry need to have an ERP software solution in order to be federally compliant?
I don't believe it's required, but it makes it super hard to do a manual.
Okay.
I mean, you could do recall manually, but that takes a ton of time and it's very difficult. Within minutes, I can show you where, if you give me a bad test, I can show you where that lot was, where it came from the raw. And I can tell you what's still on the, you know, kind of on the floor in process as a plant growing. I can tell you what's in finished goods. I can tell you where it went, if it went to a dispensary. And I can also tell you what's still in raw. And if I hit a button, I can quarantine all that, and that can't be used anymore. It's done. It stops, right? By hand, that takes a lot more time. You're kind of doing one thing at a time, and you got to go find it and go figure out what lots those were. So the systems definitely help get you there quicker. And we've written some more enhancement to that makes it even faster.
Okay. You said that you work with cultivators, processors, and on the financial side of things. Which vertical is more difficult to work with?
I think processing is pretty straightforward because I think it's no different than food and bev. Like, you know, I think cultivating, when you're getting into more, you know, vertical farming, right? It's just, it's a little bit different. You know, in our traditional agriculture stuff that we've worked on in the past, it gets us pretty close as well. But there's just some nuances in, you know, in the way we do cultivation that I think that's the part that we make sure that we get right. I think that takes a little bit more time, you know, especially because they're changing their processes. They might change the way they harvest. They might change. There's a lot of things that, you know, you need more flexibility there because people are trying different things to get the best yield they can and the best product out the door.
As you've worked on enhancements with Canna Business ERP, have you brought any of those enhancements over to the other side, the food and beverage side?
We have. Recently, we've done some enhancements to quality in the quality module, and we're using them on both sides.
Okay. What were those enhancements?
Oh, they're around some new sheets and in places where, you know, you can put an inspection sheet anywhere in the system on a QA perspective, but we've written some stuff that builds out that workflow and reporting and some additional imports that you can do into the lot attributes of a QA test that was done. So we've added some more enhancements there that have really rounded that out. It's not, I would say it's not a full QMS where, you know, QMS has got more document management control on top of workflow. We do track the documents, but not like a QMS solution does. That's a little bit different.
Okay. Do you have any, when it comes to getting customer feedback, how long does it take before that becomes an enhancement? Are you waiting to hear it a few times from clients? Do you hear it once and then sort of survey your clients? And then how quickly is it until something is written and deployed?
So, you know, we do have a roadmap of the product, you know, short term, long term, you know, middle term, and things will move between those terms based on clients, right? So we listen very, very closely to what they ask for. If it's something that feels very one-off, we haven't heard it before, we'll do a little bit more investigation on that. But if it's something that we've heard of before, or when we looked at it, we're like, wow, that's a great idea, then it gets moved in pretty quickly. You know, it just depends on the roadmap and what we're working on, because we're doing, you know, we're not only doing we do food out of that team and as we do cannabis out of that team. So that development product team does, you know, two kind of pieces. We roadmap it in there, but we come up with a lot of enhancements every quarter, you know, on both solutions, but you know, it could take, you know, a couple months. It could take a year. It just depends on what that enhancement and what the effect of the overall solution is. Like if it's something that's so impactful, we'll move things around and get it on the roadmap pretty quick.
What have you been hearing from operators lately that will likely turn into a new enhancement?
You know, I don't know if there's anything that I can think of right now. That's a great question. That would come from the IP team, because Jeff Law, who's our product manager who runs that group, was at the Vegas show, and I know he talked to a whole bunch of people, and I have not heard what was kind of come out of those meetings that he had, but I'm sure there's a few things.
Okay. So what's next for Cannabusiness ERP? What are some of the things that the Cannabis Equipment News audience could expect from the company moving forward?
You know, for us, it's just continue to you know, put out a good product, and what we're seeing is more states coming on board. So I think we're at 14 states now that we have written compliance for. We'll continue to drive that through as our MSOs keep pushing us for more, and some of those just state onlys that we're involved in. So, you know, we just got New Mexico done, you know, because one of our customers just went over there, and now we're talking to two more customers, potential customers that are there, and they're relieved that it's already done. So, you know, because we get them done as fast as we can, right? It's a core integration that we've written to Metric and for BioTrack. And then we roll them out. If it's a state we don't have done, we roll it out during implementation, right? We can make sure the testing is all done during pilot to roll that out. But we're actually now getting really efficient in rolling out those state compliances. So we'll be getting a lot of those out in the next little while this year, because, you know, New York now is becoming a priority. So, you know, we're going to start working on that, I think, fairly soon. Massachusetts is done. Florida now has picked a solution. So now we've got to work on Florida, because we've got a couple of customers in Florida as well.
Okay. So you kind of wait to see what the state does. Like, you haven't started working on Minnesota yet, just optimistically, because the governor said, put it on my desk.
Yep. Yeah, because, you know, writing it ahead of time makes no sense, because those laws get changed a lot until, you know, the drafts, and until we're finally up and running, I don't want to worry about it and to write it for someone who doesn't, there's no one there yet. So, you know, for that, you know, I think we'll have Alabama done soon, because, you know, once Alabama, I think they're going to have licenses out this year at some point, I think August, maybe. I think the applications were due at the end of the year of 2022. So, you know, I got a couple prospects that, you know, if they get their license, we'll have to get that one done as well. But you don't want to write them too soon. You want to wait till you absolutely need it, because if there's ebb and flow in those regs, right? And they're just, it takes a long time for the final draft to be done and approved.
Do you have a personal connection to the cannabis industry?
No, I really don't. I you know, it was something that we looked at it in 2015 and we all got into a room and we said, you know what, this is something that I think we could, you know, really help this industry. And, you know, I became the executive sponsor for our team to, you know, kind of help launch it. And I've been involved ever since. And it's been a great industry to be in. It's crazy at times, but it's also very rewarding when you see it all working properly and you're like, this is the way it was supposed to be. You know, I don't really have a real personal connection other than my father-in-law, you know, has Parkinson's and it's helped him, you know, medically in Florida. And you can tell there's a big difference when he tries to make, we have to remind him sometimes because he gets embarrassed about it. And we're like, yeah, no, like hit the pen, you know, you stop shaking. Like this is really works for you. So, you know, that was pretty impactful, I guess, that from a personal life, I forgot about that. But, you know, that part was, it's been special to watch and he's doing much better now because of it.
What swayed you to make you, to kind of push you to be that executive sponsor internally?
I'm kind of the person that volunteers for a lot. So, you know, when a project comes up and it's kind of cool and, you know, I feel passionate about it, that I think we can really, you know, do well because we have an exciting product that can help the industry. I typically jump onto that. So I did and was really excited about it, but I've done that most of my career of different consulting firms that I've been at is, you know, when you find that, you know, project and typically it's around some kind of an industry exciting new thing. And, you know, we really felt like we could help the industry and it made sense that it was comfortable for us because of our food backgrounds.
Okay. So for you professionally, is cannabis and ERP the end all be all, or is it until the next new market opens up for ERP that you're looking to jump on that?
No, I don't know if there's going to be another new industry. Like this is a very unique time. You know, I think about the dot-com era when that was just such a flop and, you know, this is, feels different and it has been different. It still has its struggles, especially, you know, federally, but, you know, at the end of the day, you know, I don't know if we'll ever see another thing like this in our lifetime. I just think this was a special, there's those special times that, you know, like Y2K was kind of a weird thing and it never really turned out to be anything. And then this is one of those other things that you're like, this is unique. And I don't know if we'll ever see this again, you know, this kind of excitement and impactfulness.
Do you have a prediction for federal legalization and how would it impact the company? Just, you know, you talk to some people, they're very much against it. They know it's inevitable, but they, you know, think it's going to be very disruptive. So do you have a prediction and how would it stand to impact cannabis ERP?
Well, it would put more hair and fire with us that we already did have in 2018 and 19. So, cause those were the two craziest years for us for sure. 17, 18, 19. Because that was just, Canada was, you know, just went federal and everything was actually picking up here because California went, and that was kind of a crazy time. So if it did go federal or when it goes federal, we'll have a little bit of that again, I assume. I don't know. I feel like it's still a 3-year out thing, you know, a 3 to 4, just because, you know, I think some banks are jumping the shark and jumping in anyway, even though they're, you know, it's not, the banking thing never got passed that law. But I do think it's going to happen. What I think is really going to happen, which doesn't get us excited, is I think that it could pass federally and then still mandate to the state for compliance.
Okay.
Which means we're still writing integration compliance for different, every law is going to be different by state like it is today. You know, it's going to have all those special tweaks and when it's a plant, when do you track it and all that fun stuff. So we could be federally legal, but feds could push it to the state level. And then we're kind of in the same boat. And that just means we just have a lot more maintenance to do. It's just, you know, it's just a lot to maintain.
Right. But that seems like the easiest bridge, I guess, rather than just trying to come in and do everything.
Easiest bridge for the feds, but not for us. Right. So that's okay. I mean, like I think of, you know, when you think of Health Canada, it's easy.
Yeah.
It's a report. It's like, you know, we get it done and we never have to worry about it. And that getting that regulatory in compliance with our stuff and making sure we do it right, that was not a big deal, right? Every state's different. Like, it, you know, it does take a lot more lift. a lot more, like we have to do a lot more due diligence and just do have, you know, we have to read the regs. Like there's just a lot more we have to do.
Well, that's one thing that I hear from a lot of MSOs is that, you know, initially you think that you're going to be able to streamline everything, having a bigger operation, but really it's just like however many states you're in, it's like running that many individual operations.
It is, but having it all under one umbrella and one system enables you to look at the inefficiencies and what's working, what's not working. So if you're running separate systems, and listen, we've had a lot, you know, one of our big New York ones, you know, they were running all of our competitors except us, right? And we won that deal across everybody, and now they're all on one system. Mm-hmm. Well, financial statements wise, and you know, on the finance, you know, the accounting group, that's a heck of a lot easier than running, you know, eight different solutions across all your states. It's not fun, right? That's a lot of maintenance. It's a lot of overhead.
Mm-hmm. Other than a situation like that, is the other more difficult, like during an acquisition or something like that, where you're trying to bring another entity online?
So to do it all while you're in acquisition modes can be tough, but it also could be the shining kind of star that you could handle, because we've done a couple of those where they're still on one solution. They just bought two more and they're like, you know what? We're going to use one of those as the guinea pigs and get them over because their system is so bad and we don't want to move them into the system we know we're switching out. So it kind of starts to build your phase approach of kind of what you want to do. Because once you get your template done, you're going to build a master template of this is what I want all of our facilities to do, right? Mm-hmm. You're still going to have a little bit of tweaks by state that they might have a little bit of different SOP, but they're fundamentally on the same system. So then now you've got a template. So it becomes a lot quicker to get you up as you move from facility to facility.
Well, Chris, I really do appreciate you joining me today. Before we get out of here, is there anything else that we might've left out or anything in particular you want to make sure the Cannabis Equipment News audience knows about either yourself or Cannabusiness ERP?
No, I think for us, it's just, we like doing great work for our customers. And, you know, if people are struggling in their solutions and, you know, are looking for someone to help them. And even if it's just a sounding board, because we do a lot of that too. And, you know, we tell people kind of like, hey, we may not be the right solution for you, but, you know, here's where I think you might be able to go. I mean, we're happy to always help. It doesn't mean that you have to, you know, put our solution in. You know, we're always willing to talk to people and, you know, be able to be that kind of independent consultant that says, you know, be that trusted advisor and kind of hopefully steer them down the right road, because we've seen it all. We've switched customers off of everything. So we know what the good and the bad and the ugly is. And we're very upfront about it. You know, we're very, very candid about kind of what we can do for you and maybe someone else that maybe can help you in a different way. So, you know, we try to be, you know, always upfront and honest and make sure that we're doing right by the customer.
So you've turned down business. What have you turned people away for?
We've turned away for, you know, they want to co-mingle. They're like, hey, we'd like these other three things that we like your guys' stuff, but we want to use the core, but we also still want to use these guys for the middleware piece of cultivation or for this smaller other piece. I'm like, that's just not going to work, because the integration stuff, because you're integrating and not on a single platform, mm-hmm. It all gets lost in translation. It's overhead to maintain. You never get those integrations quite right to fully capture costing, and it just becomes super inefficient. So we've walked away from people that have come back and say, hey, we're using this back office solution. We'd love to you just use your cultivation and pop it in. And we're like, yeah, it's not going to work.
Gotcha.
It just makes no sense. Like we wrote inside our development layer inside of the Sage X3, right? So we wrote just like Sage X3 writes, you know, in our development layer, right? So you can't tell it's not part of the system. Mm-hmm. And to run that, which is going to look different than your other solution, that gets super confusing for the users. And then trying to keep that right and keep it integrated properly, it just doesn't, it's just not effective.
No, have you ever seen that work?
Yeah.
No, have you ever seen that work where they were using multiple solutions and then they didn't eventually wind up going to one?
No, it doesn't work. They finally get so frustrated. And what happens is you revert back to what? Spreadsheets. Because you got to copycat everything, because you're like, whoa, that's not working right. And now we're frustrated there. And now that's not talking to that properly. We got a spreadsheet over here. So they end up reverting back to spreadsheets, and then they just suffer along. And sometimes you just get to the point where you don't know what you don't know, and you just get used to it, mm-hmm. you know, until someone finally raises their hand. And it's usually someone new that came in and said, oh, I used this solution before, and why are we doing it this way? This is hard. And yeah. And then that starts the change management side of the business, and then hopefully they call.
They're just right back in spreadsheet hell again.
Yeah.
Well, Chris, thanks again for your expertise on how ERP software is being used in cannabis. I found it really enlightening, you know, and actually pretty positive. I was unsure as to how many operators had it in the industry and the size of the companies that could really stand to benefit.
Yeah, no, it's you know, we first got in this and we did our first, I remember it was Orlando. We did our first cannabis show, it was 2016. And we said, we're an ERP solution. And everyone's like, yeah, I don't need that. I need a seed to sale. Like, oh no, we are seed to sale, but we do way more than seed to sale. And yeah. And that took like a year or two before finally people now come to the booth and go, I need an ERP solution. So, you know, the industry's gotten, you know, a lot more mature, and it's definitely moving in the right direction.
Well, Chris, thanks again. And I hope we get a chance to do it again soon.
Yeah. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on the show.
All right. Well, before we get out of here, please make sure to like, share, and subscribe to the podcast. You can also help us out a lot by leaving the podcast a positive review on whatever platform you use. Finally, if you want to email the podcast, you can reach me at david@cannabisequipmentnews.com. For Chris Milan, VP of Sales with Cannabusiness ERP, I'm David Manti. This is the Cannabis Equipment News Podcast, and we'll see you next week. Thank you for listening to the Cannabis Equipment News Podcast.